In Ephesians chapter 6, specifically 12 through 17, is a very familiar passage of Scripture. And regardless of the level of your involvement or your level of buy-in into Jesus and the church, especially here in our neck of the woods, I'm pretty sure most people have probably heard the story about the armor of God. And the reason I say that is because many times, even growing up in this area or the Bible Belt, the buckle of the Bible Belt, specifically where we're at, I'm sure you've heard of this story, or you've heard many sermons and Sunday school lessons and children church lessons about it. But there's something so powerful about the armor of God, church. Because of this reason right here, we are literally in a battle. There's a battle for your mind, there's a battle for your spirit, there's a battle for your soul. And that battle has been waged long, long, long ago. And the enemy wants nothing more than to capture that and take possession of it and to destroy you and your family in this church. You guys, if you go with me, say amen. And I know it's Memorial Day weekend, folks. Come on, listen, you need to act a little bit more festive because church is not supposed to be boring, okay? This is some powerful stuff we're talking about. We're talking about the armor of God that's been designed to protect us from the enemy. Now can you say amen? And so that's where we've been these last few weeks, talking. We're going piece by piece in each piece of the armor, and really specifically talking about that and our connection to that, both spiritually and also physically. Because when Paul wrote this, he used a physical illustration to really talk about a spiritual truth that we don't really see in the physical realm, but the spiritual realm, there's a lot going on, and this is why you have to connect both to really appreciate the armor of God. So let's read our text. It's taken out of Ephesians chapter 6, starting in verse 12. And it says it right off there. I included verse 12 because this is the reason why we put on the armor of God. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers, against the world forces of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the full armor of God so that you will be able to resist in the evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Stand firm, therefore, having girded your loins with the belt of truth, that's strapping on your belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. In addition to all that, taking up the shield of faith, which with you will be able to extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. And take up the helmet of salvation, which we're going to be talking about today, and then the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much for today, God. I thank you just for your presence, Lord. This messenger today is so overwhelmed by your power, by your love, by your grace, by your mercy, by your provision, Lord. I'm just overwhelmed today, God. Really need your help. I need your power. I need your anointing to be on this. This word is already powerful. It's anointed. It's sharper and quicker than any two-edged sword. So that for itself, it's powerful. But Lord, this messenger today needs your power to flow through. God, I don't want it to be Edgar's words. I want it to be your words, Father. Lord, just use this messenger today to deliver a very powerful and life-changing message to all of us. I ask this in your name. Everybody says amen and amen. I'm really so looking forward to talking about today, because this is one of my favorite pieces of armor to talk about, obviously because the connection that it has to me specifically growing up, and many of you who probably have used this type of armor, believe it or not. The main purpose of a helmet is to, whether it's in battle or in sports or in construction, or if you're in any type of that situation, you've got to protect your head. Ultimately, what you're trying to protect is your brain, which ultimately what you're protecting is the mind. And specifically here in our church, there's many of you who've been talking and feasting on that subject of the mind of Christ and the mind and how all that ties in, and so appropriate we're going to be talking about that today as a church. But that's really what it's there to protect. Now, I was able to borrow a piece of equipment from, if you guys can see this from, this is Jaden's, right, or is it Tristan's? I'm not sure if it's Jaden's. Jaden Chambers, thank you, bud. Let me use your helmet. I appreciate that. And this is a Union Grove helmet, guys. You say amen. And those of you who don't like Union Grove, you're going to get over it. That's what we're using today, okay, folks? But thank you guys for letting me use this. But as you can see, and I know we're talking about sports, and you tell you, oh my gosh, you're going to be talking about football, and I get it, folks, but Paul used so many, and all the writers, really, many writers use physical illustrations to get to put across his spiritual truth. Now, football here in Texas, I'd say it's pretty popular here in East Texas. I know towns literally shut down for football, so this is where we're going to be for the next few minutes. As you can look inside of this thing, it is well padded. Can you say amen? I'm sure everybody can see that. I feel like Dana White here, just kind of going like this, going like that. Here's your helmet, well padded up. It's there to protect. I know something, and this is the misconception sometimes with people who really don't understand football, how it all ties in. People, that they see a helmet, they think, well, that's there to protect your face. Because for some of you, that's your moneymaker, right, guys? Your face is your moneymaker. You guys are so asleep today, man. Try to help me out here, folks. Maybe because it's not your moneymaker, somebody's been lying to you, okay, folks? It's not really there to protect your moneymaker. It's there to protect what's inside, and that's your brain. Your mind is what's there to protect. Now, in a football player, this is so, so important. So I was going to try to put this on, but then I saw the size, and there's no way possible to fit my big head in this. But we'll set this right here so you guys can see. So let me move this one here. You guys can stare at the helmet here. But in football, and again, I love that Paul uses physical illustration, if you will, to really talk about what this is. But this thing was designed to absorb to some degree. Now there's more and more studies to where that's even, you know, not protecting completely, but it's there to absorb the hits, you know, the pounding of the ground that happens, if you will, to many who happen to play this sport. Now, a lot of mothers out there are already cringing because you pray that every practice, every game, your kid gets to come home safely. And it's a brutal sport. I understand that. But in football, the quarterback, you guys remember with the quarterback? Let me give you a little football lesson. The quarterback plays a very important role. Every role is important, but the quarterback's such an important role because they're the ones, they're the leader of the team. They're the ones who call the plays, or at least they execute or they communicate that play to the offense. They're saying, this is what we've been told to do. Here's the play we need to run. And so this is how we're supposed to execute it, and everyone that's on the offense has a certain role that they need to stay in order to score points. And football is not like golf, where the low scores end up being in football. You've got to score as many points as you can. That's how you win. You guys with me, say amen. I understand. I'm going to assume everyone here understands football. Even then, even here in Texas, people still don't know what this sport's all about. So the quarterback's there to run the plays, but here's where it gets a little, and this is where you start getting a little bit of spiritual implication. The quarterback is constantly under the rest. I mean, he's running the plays, but there's an opposition. There's a whole other group of 11 guys, and in our school, truly it's 6. But there's a whole other team on the other side, and their whole entire purpose, literally, is to pretty much murder this poor guy that's holding his ball. I mean, that's what it comes down to. Their whole entire purpose is to slam him to the ground, to hurt him. Well, not necessarily, but it does happen sometimes. To take this thing right here, okay? They want to sack him. They want to flush him out of the pocket, because there's his pocket that's created, so they want to flush him out of there. These huge guys are there to literally try to tear this poor guy apart. Because they know if he's able to execute the plays that's been called, then they have a greater chance of scoring a touchdown or scoring some points. And you keep trying to accumulate these points to get out there. So you have this struggle back and forth that's happening between the offense and the defense, and what's happening there is a lot going on there. And that's kind of how all that comes into play. Now, there's a whole other part to this, and I'm not sure if many really understand this, but there's another player, if you will, that plays a huge part in what's happening on the field. On the offense side of it, especially, there's someone called the offensive coordinator. The offensive coordinator is one of the coaches. And the offensive coordinator, in many, many occasions, especially in pro football, that guy sits up way high in a booth where they can oversee everything. That's the offensive coordinator. The offensive coordinator has this little headset on. You guys know what I'm talking about, saying that everyone's saying kind of got the degree, like you guys are, I haven't watched you completely. So you have the offensive coordinator with his headset And now through technology, now they have different races still call plays, and you see people holding up signs, you have just, you know, signals that are done like in baseball. You have all that going on, but now you have it to where the offensive coordinator communicates to the quarterback wearing this helmet, the plays. He's communicating to him, hey, this is where and this is what you need to do next. Based off of what I can see, because listen, the offensive coordinator sits way up high. They can see the whole field of play. They've seen what the defense has been doing and probably is going to do, and they have a really good chance to be able to predict what's probably going to happen next. You guys are with me on that? The offensive coordinator spent hours and so much time in strategizing against the opposition, against the enemy, against the defense. They study films and they watch certain tendencies and they watch what that defense is probably going to do. So the offense has an edge to some degree. I don't know if you ever picked up on that, but the offensive player knows what they're going to do. The defense is just reacting to what the offense is doing. You guys with me on that? That's how football works out. Now you have some exceptional, crazy talented defensive players out there that usually can read things, but for the most part, the advantage is on the offense. They're the ones who know the plays. They know how to, and as they execute the play correctly, they're able to advance the ball into the end zone and finally score. But the offensive coordinator plays such a huge part because that individual is communicating all this information down here, down to the quarterback, down to the person who's receiving it, and then in turn, just putting all the game plan together. Now listen to me, this is where you and I tie in. Because for us, the deciding factor in victory or defeat all happens in the mind. You said with me, say amen. Those of you who have been in the Sunday school class know exactly where I'm going with this, because having that mind of Christ is so powerful, because the mind operates and tells the body what to do. Here's a truth I'm going to give to you real quick. If the mind operates on a false reality of the truth, then the body will also function according to this false reality. So if somehow the offensive coordinator kind of messed things up, and or maybe the quarterback just receives information and says, you know what, I'm not going to listen to my leader up there who's already seen the field of play. The leader up there spent hours and has all the knowledge and is trying to help me, give me the right information for me to be able to achieve victory. But if that quarterback somehow refuses to receive that information and starts acting or operating under a false reality of what he thinks is probably best, do you think the quarterback's going to have any amount of success? Probably not. Because he's acting on his own thoughts, his own ability, his own, yes, they're with me, his own thought process. He's thinking through, I know better than that person that's way up high. Any spiritual tying yet, folks? Proverbs 23:7 says, as he thinks within himself, so he is. The mind needs protection, folks. Here, listen to me. The mind needs protection from lies. I don't know about you guys, but maybe I'm the only human in this room, but I've been lied to somehow, even sometimes have believed some of those lies the enemy might tell me about myself. And as a dumb jock somehow, I'll listen to myself or refuse to listen to the information given to me from my father and try to operate under my own ability. It's got me in a whole heap of trouble before. So lies, half-truths, false realities. Come on, folks, you with me today? We need protection from impurity. Because of the evilness and this nasty world we happen to live in, folks, and this isn't just legalistic talk, this world we live in, there's so much available that's out there to literally fill your mind with all kinds of junk. Come on, church, you with me this morning? Preach with me here. Because when you walk out these doors, it's safe in here, but I'm telling you, folks, the instant we walk out of here, folks, this isn't a scare tactic. This is including this married man, a father of two, great feeling, but I understand there's so much that is out there that wants to poison my mind and keep me from operating under the game plan that God has set out for me. He wants me to operate under myself. Sometimes we get this misconception that the enemy's out there. If he convinces you to do things on your own thinking, then he's already won. That's one way of really looking at that issue, is we think that the devil's just filling your mind with all kinds of, you know, pitchfork and just nastiness, and he's out there looking like the boogeyman, or he looks like Freddy Krueger, and he's there to terrorize your mind. I mean, that's not how, folks, if that's how the enemy worked, then why does some of us ever have sin? Why do we ever commit sin? He's there to kind of convince us that it's okay, that it's good. You do your own thing out there, and God created your mind. Why can't you use your own mind to do things? Folks, that's where the enemy really gets us. The buying into these truths, or these half-truths, or these half-lies, I'm going to look at it. And that's where our mind needs protecting. But the other side of this is the helmet of salvation. And this is the point I'm trying to get to today. When it comes to salvation. It's called the helmet of salvation. And I believe, listen to this, that our mind, if we're going to have this mind of Christ, if we're going to have this thinking that lines up with God's word, that we have to have a clear understanding of what salvation is all about. Because I don't know if we understand it completely. But listen, this is what I mean by this. 1 Thessalonians 5:8. But since we belong to the day, listen to that. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, putting on the faith and love as a breastplate, and the hope of salvation as a helmet. Did you catch that? But since we belong to the day, let's break that down. Since we belong to the day, that's the author's way of saying, listen, because you live here on earth, the sun is going to rise, the sun's going to set. That's your day. You have no other choice but to face that day. Now, you can lay under the covers in your bed all day, folks, but it doesn't stop the sun from rising. That day is going to happen, which means that day contains a lot of junk out there that's there to destroy you and wants to bring you down. So the author is saying, since we belong to the day, there's no escaping that. Let us be sober, putting on, that means sober is clear in thinking. That's what that word means right there, is be sober. Be clear in thinking. Use your judgment. Use your mind correctly. Have that mind of Christ. So have the mind on the faith and love as a breastplate and the hope of salvation as a helmet. Now let's talk a little bit about salvation. Now I threw this little teaser out there a couple of days ago to see if you guys get some of your attention. But we got a video clip I'm going to set you up because I want you guys to see this. Think about it. When did he become a millionaire? He became a millionaire when he acquired the land. here's the problem with that. When he acquired that land, he had no understanding of how valuable that land was that he owned. You still with me on that? That's when he became a millionaire, is when he acquired the land. He was sitting on a gold mine, so to speak, for the longest time. But old Jed was struggling. You guys heard the song, guys. He was struggling to keep his family fed. This guy was struggling for years, and yet the answer was right there in the very thing he possessed, the land. And it wasn't until he finally went hunting someday and he discovered the oil. But here's the other problem with that, folks. Listen to me. The other problem with that is when old Jed, you guys know the whole story, right? When old Jed discovered he's a millionaire, all of a sudden he moves his family out to Beverly Hills, right? California, all that junk. We understand all that. Even knowing all that and even acquiring all that wealth, they still lived out their lives like what? Hillbillies. Right in the middle of Beverly Hills. You're saying, Edgar, what in the world are you coming with that? Here's the implication, folks. Listen to me. Some of us are sitting on a gold mine, if you will, when it comes to our salvation. Some of us don't realize what salvation truly means, and so therefore we still live our lives like spiritual hillbillies just struggling to get by. And that's not the life that God intended for you to have. Come on, folks, that's preaching today. That's good stuff, right there. Many of us are living today without the full knowledge. Listen, and knowledge ties into the mind. It all ties in, folks. I haven't lost my mind, trust me. But many of us are living today without the full knowledge, the mind, of what we've been given in salvation. Listen, one reason we fail to recognize the magnitude of this gift, listen to me. One reason we fail to recognize the magnitude of this gift is because we have limited understanding of what salvation is. Because we have this understanding that salvation is just going to heaven. You guys ever heard that salvation has been compared to fire insurance? You guys ever heard that? I got my fire insurance. I'm good. I'm good, folks. Come on, that's all I need right there now. Come on. I got my fire insurance. I'm going to be good. I'm going to squeeze into them pearly gates. I'm going to be sliding in, but I'm getting in. I don't know where the hillbilly talk just came from, but there we go. But if that's our idea of salvation, folks, then I've got some bad news for you. You're missing out on so much living. I get that a lot going on, especially when they find out you're a preacher. Like, oh, man, you must not know what living is. I mean, you must live in sheltered lives. You really don't know happiness. You don't know what the world is. I said, no, listen, let me stop you there. Because I am a Christian, it has nothing to do with being a pastor. But because I'm a Christian, I've discovered an incredible wealth of living. Trust me. I've never been happier. I've never had more peace. Come on, folks. It's like life got better the instant I discovered that what salvation truly meant. It had nothing to do with just fire insurance or just getting into heaven. I'm gaining more of an understanding what salvation is all about, folks. And it all starts in your mind. You got to know how to think like you're saved. If we figure this out right here, folks, I'm telling you, this is so huge. I'm so glad that God's taking the entire church through this right now. Even our kids department is talking about this. Because it all starts right here. We've got to start living and quit struggling day to day just to get by, folks. I'm telling you, this isn't prosperity preaching. If you think that's it, you just missed it. That's not what I'm talking about. But there's so much freedom, there is so much prosperity, there is so much to living a life of victory because it's how you think what salvation truly is to you. What is salvation is so much more to just that. Can I just take you through that? Yes, salvation does include eternity. It does include spending forever with Christ. There's so much more than that, guys. The key term connected to salvation is freedom. Y'all say that? Freedom. That's the key word that's connected to salvation. That's why I feel there's so much freedom in living a life of Christ. Because of Christ, I'm able to do so much. Come on, folks, say amen. That's what salvation means. So in your notes, I'm going to give you some practical information on what salvation means, and then I'll give you some to walk out of this church with and then we'll pray. This is awesome stuff. Because salvation is actually threefold. It is so much to it. So let's talk about salvation, okay? Salvation is freedom from the past. Write that in your notes. Salvation is freedom from the past. The other word that you can associate with that, and I'm going to get some little fancy words, but just hear me out here. The word I associate with that is justification. Freedom from the past is justification. It's the removal of the penalty of sin. Along comes that, comes with that is righteousness. Because remember, you're not righteous because of yourself. We're not that good, folks. We're made righteous because of what Christ did for us. So because of what Christ did, he removes that penalty. Because really, it should be you and I on the cross. I know I just burst some of your bubbles. You're thinking, I don't deserve that. Yeah, we all deserve death. In fact, the penalty of sin is what? Death. We don't like to talk about that in church. That makes us uncomfortable. And we start getting our sweaty. And then we find another church that do it to you. But this church, we're going to talk about sin because that's exactly what it is. It's death. It's what it leads to. But because of salvation, because of what Christ did, there's a removal of that penalty of sin, and we get to live a life of freedom. That justification, that freedom from the past, is what happens when you accept Christ as your personal Savior. So if you're saved today, if you're a Christian here in this room right now, you experience that justification. You had that moment when Christ came in and you said yes. You had that moment where you said, okay, I'm going to yield my heart, I'm going to yield my life, I'm going to give everything to Christ. I belong to him. That's justification. Another way to say it, here's how I remember justification, is just as if I've never sinned. That's a heavier way of, I like to simplify things. So justification is a fancy word. It means just as if you've never sinned. That's what it comes into right there. Christ looks at me, the sinner, and says, Edgar, you deserve to go on that cross, but because I gave my son to pay for that, when you became a Christian, you accepted this love and this grace and this mercy that I offer you, it's just as if you've never sinned. Isn't that awesome, church? So that's what, can we understand that side of it? That's the easy side. Here's more of what salvation means. This is why every day I can live out freedom, because it's also freedom from the presence. Let me write that in your notes. It's freedom from the presence. Sanctification. How many's ever heard that word? We don't use that word much in church anymore, but that is, believe it or not, we used to use it a lot. Sanctification is it's another fancy way of saying freedom from the present. What salvation also provides for us, folks, listen, is an ongoing renewal through the work of the Holy Spirit, because you can't leave that element out. And that's part of God, is the power of the Holy Spirit. If the Spirit's alive in you, you have that function happening in your mind that gives you the opportunity to have that mind of Christ. Come on, church, you're with me today. So because of the power of the Holy Spirit, and yes, we are a Spirit-led church, we celebrate the Holy Spirit here in this church. If you are not filled, you need to get filled. But then that's part of what we are. Because of the power of the Holy Spirit, it assists us into this ongoing renewal of salvation. We talked about this in the Belt of Truth when we first started all this, but this is why we have to get up every morning. Listen to me. Even if you're not a morning person, I get that. Morning for you is like 11 a.m. I guess that's still morning, but you really slept half the day off. But listen, that morning we need to set our minds on the things of Christ right off the bat, because that's where the enemy is going to go first. If you know he can get you thinking defeat, guess what, folks? You're probably going to walk in defeat that day. I know it's a goofy illustration, but there's that offensive coordinator kind of feeding information into your mind. Some of you probably don't understand football analogies, but a lot of people do, but it's that simple. The Father is communicating to you through the power of the Holy Spirit, but he also communicates to you through the Bible, the Word of God. There's so much in there, and so all this information is being fed, so it'll give you the game plan for that day. But guess what? Like I said a while ago, The offensive coordinators have spent hours studying the opposition. They watch film. They understand probably what the defense is going to do or how the defense is going to react to what the offense might do. And so the offensive coordinator already plans ahead for that. Guess what, folks? The Bible is full of information to give you the game plan on how to live a victorious life every day. He knows you're probably going to face an impossibility. He knows you're probably going to face discouragement. He knows you're probably going to face disappointment. He probably knows. No, there's no probably. Listen, he knows it all. And in that morning, when we experience that renewal of our mind, he's also preparing our mind for what will or possibly could happen that day. So if something is to happen that'll bring defeat, we're prepared for it mentally. So therefore, it'll react in how we walk, and how we talk, and where we go. Folks, it all ties in. Come on, folks, you with me here today. The mind of Christ, this mind is such a powerful weapon. And the more we understand how we think, I'm trying to teach you as a church, we need to think a little bit better on what salvation truly means. It's so much more than just saying, hello, I'm saved. No, it's hello, I am free today because of my salvation. We get to live out freedom here on earth before we even celebrate that in heaven. We get to celebrate freedom now. Is it tough out there? Absolutely, folks. It's the world. It's designed to destroy you. That defense was to knock you down. I know that might hurt some of your feelings. Maybe you think in all that, you're just free from all that. Yeah. No, you're not. No, you're not. Oh, you're right. I just fumbled the ball. I was close. Can't fumble. The enemy wants to tear you down, folks. I can't move from that point. But we understand. We get to have freedom in the present. We get to have freedom from whatever this day is going to bring to you today. Because I don't know, when you walk out this door, some of you might experience some heartache. Might experience some pain. Might get a phone call tomorrow morning that your health just isn't what you think it is. There's some truth right there. There's a reality. Some of you might wake up tomorrow morning and maybe having a pretty hard time getting out of bed because your back is so hurting you can't possibly even move to even get yourself out of bed. How many of you ever had those kind of days? I have those every day. It hurts. But I have to set my mind in a victorious life. Come on, folks, are you with me today? In my mind, I have to lay there and say, devil, you ain't going to have no part of this body today. You can tear it down. You can try to tell me whatever you want. But I know I'm living a victorious life. I know my healing is right there. I'm experiencing my healing. Come on, folks. It's all in how you think. I'm not trying to trick you into brainwashing you. It's scriptural to think like you've been healed. It's scriptural to think like your marriage has already been put together when it's in shambles right now. It's scripture to think, kids, that you're out of school, that when you face school again in August, that you can actually lead your entire school to Christ. Because there's been students who have done that already. They've went to school and led thousands, thousands, thousands to Christ. If that's not your thinking, guys, then you're wasting people's time and living your life. You have to go to school thinking, today's the day I get to lead one person, influence them for Christ. That's how it works, honey. All of us have to face that day. Some of you adults might be facing that day where they're looking at you going, man, I'm sorry, guys, we're going to have to cut down. You've lost your job. Anybody experience one of those kind of awesome days? How's your mind going to be set that day? If you didn't prepare for it that morning, guess what? Chances are you probably already thought in your mind that you wanted to kick that dude in the throat, didn't you? Let's just be honest, folks. I don't know why we're acting for all churches here, supposedly. We're all human beings. You wanted to literally keep that guy in the throat, didn't you? How many of you ever lost your job? It don't feel good. How many? Yeah, you just went out to celebrate it, didn't you? Have you some fajitas? I've just been fired. This is good. I'm just happy. No, man. It's devastating. You lost your means to live. It's bad news. What's your mindset then? If you didn't prepare for your mindset that morning that something possibly could happen that day because we live in a reality of a harsh world, I I probably would have went that day. How about, here, let's get even more real. This is the presence. About how about for some of you who we might sometimes we go to the, this is why one reason why I quit going is being very transparent right now. I probably should go more because of my physicality, I need to be in shape. But I finally had to stop going to the gym because I just didn't want to look at girls, to be honest with you. Now I'm being really real on the subject, some of you probably didn't fuck with. The reason why I stopped going, it's hard for me. Now, I already had this conversation with Stephanie, so don't run out here thinking, oh, your husband's struggling with lush. Did you hear about that? I'm just saying, I don't know where I heard that from. I just said it in the pulpit, okay? I'm being totally transparent with you, because some pastors don't like doing that mess, but guess what? I'm going to be really real with you. I stopped going, because it was a mind thing for me. I didn't want to look at girls that way. I had to constantly bounce. That's a term that we use to not look. So I was constantly bouncing, but I almost fall. I really did fall off one time. I fell off just thinking whatever thing I was on. I was like, and I'm like, it wasn't because I'm not coordinated, it's because I didn't want to look somewhere, but I can't look to where I'm at, so I totally fell off the thing. And it hurt. What did it all boil down to? I didn't want my mind to go to places I didn't want it to go to, so I had to take that mind for Christ and put myself out of a situation so I didn't have to look. I'm sorry if I hurt some of your feelings for me to be that transparent, but I'm still human. Amen, folks? I love my wife. I already had this conversation with her, so she knows what I'm saying, so don't run out here and tell that junk, folks. I'm going to tell her. I don't know where it came from, so I'll put it in front. Okay? No, we've had this conversation. And she looked at me and said, I've never respected you more because you recognize something about that. I got to find other means to lose weight, but I just couldn't put myself in that position anymore. It wasn't healthy for my marriage. It wasn't healthy for me. It wasn't healthy for me as a pastor. I recognize I'm almost standing behind this pulpit and tell you guys to have the mind of Christ. I've got to be able to practice that myself. I'm not a hypocrite. I have failures, but I'm not going to lie to you. So that's how you get freedom from the present. This wasn't even on my notes. This was not scripted. I just felt the Holy Spirit need to say that to you. Because you're looking at me going, well, you got it all together. You got it all figured out. No, I don't. No, I don't. I have anger issues too sometimes. This might seem something silly to you, but there's certain things in my driving that drives me nuts. And my kids know this. Gabby's laughing. I yell at people. That's a mind thing. I gotta stop doing that. I literally yell at people if they're going 70 because that drives me nuts. I'm gonna go 85 and 90. And if you're in my way, I know John laughing, but that's the truth. I'm being real with you. In my mind, I already ran them off the road. Okay? I know I have anger issues. I know I'm trying to work on that. I don't know why I've done this. What a spill on you guys. I want you to see me as a real person who every day I have to put on that mind. I put on this helmet every day, folks. Okay? That's why I put it on. Did I run those people off the road? No. I just switched the station and found some kind of peaceful jazz and just took a breath. I can only go 7 today. I guess it's one of those things. Okay? God forbid I go 50, because then I just want to kill myself. But there's my mind. If I didn't put on this helmet, guard my mind, have it transformed to take on Christ's mind, then in my mind, if I already thought it, what does Scripture say? I've already done it. And shame on me for that. So I don't want my mind to go that direction. But are you still with me here today? Come on, man. This is real preaching today. Okay? So you can't have freedom from the presence. Sanctification. You're in the process of being saved. Because I don't know about you, but I'm not sanctified yet, folks. Come on, everybody want to preach, I'm sanctified. I'm not there yet. I'm not perfect. As Mark said, we never will be, not like that. But I want my mind to be like Christ, though. You guys with me today, church? That's how you live out salvation. If you guys are still living on your fire insurance, you're missing out on so much living. I promise you that. I'll move on because I spent more than I needed to on that. The next one is freedom from the future. Freedom from the future. The word I have with that is glorification. Hallelujah. Glorification. Your life will be glorified in the presence of God. Because of salvation, folks, and I just said this, because of salvation, you will spend eternity with Christ. That's incredible, folks. That's hard to wrap our mind around with. You ever try to think about eternity? Has your mind ever gone there? You ever thought about forever what that might feel like? It's really hard for us to think that way because I get tired. I mean, I love the worship, I love to sing, but I can't picture singing for 18 hours. It's hard for me to imagine that. Of course, my mind isn't completely there yet, but maybe when I get to heaven, I see everything that Christ has done, and I look upon his face, I probably will be singing for 28 hours. I'll be happy. But more than that, we get to spend eternity with the creator of the universe, folks. If you need breath, your mind around there, that's glorification. For some of us, we're going to get that glorified body. So I might be not going to the gym like I used to after some exercise regime. I get that, but I'm going to get a whole new body. It's even hotter than this. And I know it's hard for you to imagine that, okay? Try to wrap your mind around that. Something hotter than this. I get it, folks. It's awesome. It's going to get better. I'm going to get a glorified body. But that's not really what it's about. All that back pain I'm going through, it's gone. I don't deal with that. Some of you guys know back pain. I'm looking at some of you guys. Probably worse than mine. That's gone. I don't think about that. Cancer? I hate cancer. I'm done with cancer. We're not even going to hear that word in heaven. Are you still with me yet? That's the glorification. We won't have to deal with that depression, discouragement that's causing people to lose lives. We're not going to experience that anymore. Folks, there's something beautiful about heaven. That's what you got to look forward to, so you get freedom from the future. That's what salvation, folks. So now, that's having that mind thing, it all ties into the helmet. Quit living like stinking Jed Clampett. Why are we struggling in our finances? Are you tithing? I know Austin says that all the time, and some of you guys are already starting to tune that fork it out. But he's preaching truth. If you're not tithing, I can understand why you're probably struggling with your finances, because you don't get it. I know I got really quiet then, didn't I? My wife and I this week experienced provisions in a way we never even imagined this week. I'm just being honest with you. Never even saw it coming. And I looked at Stephanie and said, Stephanie, you think God really cares about, and there's a certain thing that happened. If it was small, maybe, I'm not even going to say it, you're thinking, really? No, but I mean, serious. It was so insignificant, really. But I said, Stephanie, you think God really cares about this right here? And Stephanie looked at me and says, no, but he cares about you. And he loves blessing those who are faithful. And that, man, I'm telling you, this whole weekend's been that kind of a weekend. I can't wait to see what else God's going to do next, because he's been doing thing after thing after thing, and I didn't even see it coming. It's been awesome, folks. But living a life of freedom, you can achieve that. Some of us battle discouragement or depression. You don't have to live in a cave in a dark room somewhere, folks. You can come out of that house sometimes. Now, I'm not making fun of that, because that's a reality for some. But you don't have to live like that. You can face the world and face it head on. Why? Because of your salvation. He has sanctified you. He has justified you. He is sanctifying you. And one of these days, it's going to be some glorifying. Why? Because of your salvation. Isn't that awesome, church? Let me close with this. Really quick, I'm going to fly through these. So here's your application. I must examine what I see and hear. This is the how you do it, okay? So I'm even giving you the how to. You must examine what you see and hear. Listen, because of this right here, and I know, John, you spent some time on this, but because of this right here, you control what goes in and what comes out. Are you still with me now? That's not really popular preaching anymore because that steps on some of your perception. I'm sorry, but I will. We've got to watch what we put in. We have to watch what comes out. That's part of it. What are you watching? What are you listening to? What conversations are you listening to? We just talked about this in Sunday school. If all you're listening to is gossip all day, I can almost promise you live a really very negative lifestyle. Because all that's doing is tearing people down. How's that positive? Woo! If all we're listening is junky music, this talk talking about killing somebody's dog or stealing somebody's girlfriend or licking some, I don't know. I don't even know where that's going. If that's all the heck you're listening to, folks, listen. You wonder why sometimes our mind goes to crazy places. You ever think about some of the junk we put in our minds? I'm just throwing that out there. That's not popular preaching either. That's the reality of it. What are you watching? If you let your mind watch nothing but junk, especially pornography, what's going to come out? This is why some of our marriages are falling apart, because we expect our wives or our husbands to perform and do things we see on this screen. You're thinking, that's Hollywood. Actually, that's not even Hollywood. That's Trashywood. I don't even know what that is over there. And we want our lives to portray what's on those screens, folks. I'm just preaching real today, folks. I'm sick of marriages falling apart at all points to the mind. They're putting in junk, and so therefore they expect junk. And that's the kind of marriage they have, is a junky marriage. It doesn't work that way. So you gotta watch what you see. I know, I'm gonna get on this. Garbage in, garbage out. That's good preaching, whether you like or not. Amen. Back to man. I must allow God's word to guide me. Kind of ties into that. I must allow God's word to guide me. Psalms 119, 133 says, direct my footsteps according to your word. Let no sin rule over me. Everybody says. And last but not least, I must be inspired towards continual growth. You've got to be inspired to keep growing, folks. If you think you've arrived in your relationship with Christ, then you know they have. Somebody's been lying to you because you're not there. I'm your pastor. I humbly serve you. And I was humbled all over again this past week. What an incredible vote of confidence. But I'm telling you, just because of the incredible vote I received, does that make me pastor of the year? And I can kind of just do what I want and I'm keep growing? No! I want to keep growing because I want to be a better father. I want to be able to parent Gabby and Jade in the way that God is pleased with that. I want to serve my wife in the way that she doesn't even see coming. I want to surprise her someday at how good I am. But I can't do that if it comes from God, because I'm growing as a husband. I want to be a better pastor. I realize I don't have it all. I know I don't. But I want to grow as a pastor because I want to lead you in places that you haven't been yet. And I don't need that hobby. I want to go to those places. I want to go to the secret, but I want to go to those places that God has for this church. But I can't take you there if I've never been there. How can I lead that? I want to be a better leader for you, church. I vow that to you. But that ties into salvation. It's how I think. I want to be a better leader to the staff that I've been blessed to have, folks. And if you don't know that yet, we've got an awesome staff. I love you. I love this couple right here with all my heart. I don't know if they know that, but I'm going to tell them again today. I love this couple with all my heart. I love this couple. The other couple's homesick right now. I love this couple. I love Darwin. I love the staff that we have. I want to lead these guys in a way that pleases God. Because I want these guys to go in places they've never even been before. Because he'll be a better worship leader, folks. They'll be a better youth pastor, better children's pastor. How does that happen? Because their pastor's elevated, taken off the lid, and he's growing himself so that they can grow and we can lead you guys. Come on, folks. That's good stuff today.